with a dream, my cardigan.
All right, what's up, YouTube? I know how y'all doing out there. A lot of y'all have seen a lot of questions on the Discord server asking about some changes to the channel, so let me address those real quick. First of all, yes, the rumors are true. I am now the Mathiplier. Let's get this hashtag going. Second, people got questions about an old partner of mine. We are not going to say his name. Just going to let you know that we are going to rise up when people try to hold us down, do their own thing. Let them do it. You've always got to be you. Besides, if you're looking for mugs, this is the place to get them. Check out the link I've got in the description. We got a brand new sale going on. We got Nerds Rule for the gamer guys. We got Rainbow Unicorn for the gamer girls. And you know everyone agrees that chocolate is always the answer. Make sure you click like, share, leave a comment, and subscribe. All right, I'm going to head out. Time to get on the rocket ship because we are on the way up. All right, good morning, guys. I want to back up and talk about a couple of things first. The grade so far, you will see that as of this morning, the grade book has been updated with the grades that I've taken. And so far in all the advanced math classes, things look pretty good. Now, as of this filming, the day before, I was not quite sure with some of the classes what the success rate was going to be with the homework from, he had to think about it for a second, today is Wednesday, the second of the two transformations. And I did get some emails, and I do want to apologize a little bit. You know, it's kind of different having to do it in this form. So set everything else here aside for a second. If you're still having problems with the translations, especially the complicated ones, I'm thinking especially about number 4 on yesterday's homework. It is important to remember the order of operations. And in previous videos, I implied, and I want to say I implied incorrectly, that you really got options about how to go about it. With simple ones, that's going to work, but in complex ones, if you don't follow a particular order, you're going to generally get the wrong answer, and I'm sure, unfortunately, some of you discovered that. So in general, we're going to handle all of our horizontal shifts and reflections. In other words, everything that involves the X, we're going to do that first. Now, when I say horizontal shift, that's going to be the first thing we do. Remember, that's represented by C. It's either adding or subtracting something to our exponent. And then we're going to do our reflection. Now remember, even though this is a reflection about the x-axis, because it's about the x-axis, what it's affecting is the y-point. So in other words, you may have discovered by now those are either going to be positive or negative. Then we're going to deal with our vertical shifts, up or down, and then our reflection about the y-axis. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. I'm giving some thought to a quiz on Monday. And I'm telling you right now that since we're working at a distance here, I'm probably not going to give you any transformations that involve 3 transformations at once, probably just a maximum of 2. So if you have any more questions, don't forget, today, 10 o'clock, I'll be in the live conference. That worked out pretty well on Tuesday. We're going to make some changes to that more than likely. All right, so let's talk about what we're going to do today. Once you get the hang of this, this is really, really going to be easy. But I am going to tell you, every single one of you who were asking why we deal with exponential functions in the first place, tomorrow is where this is really going to gain some richness. So really, really pay attention here. So we have a basic exponential function here in its standard form, positive base to the x power. Now, exponential functions are what is known as one-to-one functions. And the simple way we can describe what that is that it means that for every point that exists in the domain, there's only one connected point in the range. To put it in other, maybe simpler terms, for every x point, there's only one y point. And if you look, you can sort of see this. Now, this is going to sound familiar to you from Algebra 1. This means that this function passes what is known as the horizontal line test. Now, you may recall back in Algebra 1 something called the vertical line test, where you just drew a line through, and if it touched 2 points, then you knew it wasn't a function. This is a variation of that. We won't get into it too much right now. What it means is that it allows us to do something called relating bases. It allows us to solve for exponents when they're stated in different ways. So in other words, we can find ways to relate to seemingly complex and unrelated things by making them similar. And the base of this is, poor choice of words. The base of this is right here. If I have if I have something equal to itself, the same base, but they have different exponents. In other words, you see here, if b to the u is equal to b to the v, then by definition, u is equal to v. Now, it might not make a ton of sense to you right now, but when we look at some examples in a minute, hopefully it'll clarify. This is what we call relating the bases. And all that means is to be able to work with these exponentials and do complex math with them, which we will start tomorrow. We're going to look at some real practical applications tomorrow. We have to relate the bases. The short version on that is it means you're going to get an equation that has two things on either side of it. And we have to solve for x in that equation, just like we do for any other equation. But the first step to doing that, because the x is going to be in the exponent, because these are exponential equations by their nature, is we have to make the bases that contain those exponents the same on both sides, and then we can set the exponents equal to one another and solve for x. That said, I'm going to get rid of all this, so if you want to pause and take a look and get any of this down, now would be the time. So we're going to take a look at three examples from your notes of various complexity. My guess is the first one is probably not going to be that complicated for you. I set it down somewhere, and now I don't know where I set it down. I'll be right back. Okay, I found it. It was actually right next to me on the floor here, but I don't know how to look for things. So there's going to be two things that you need to be able to work with that you kind of got to dredge up from your old algebra memory. One is recognizing squares, cubes, etc. Because you're going to see in many of these problems, we have to understand, we have to be able to look at a number and go, oh, I can turn that into a base and an exponent. The other is you're going to have to remember your basic product and power rules for exponents. So that is like when we're multiplying x to the second times x to the fifth, we add those two exponents to get x to the seventh. Or to put it another way, when we raise a power to a power, like x cubed to the third power, we multiply those and we get x to the sixth. The last one is remembering how negative exponents work. Remember, when we have a negative exponent, we can essentially think of it as going from the numerator to the denominator of a fraction or vice versa. And you've had a chance to work with that a little bit in the stuff so far. So let's take a look at this first one. So we've got to solve for x. Got 8 equals 1 over 16 to the x. So right now you should be telling yourself, okay, I can reduce these to similar bases. And hopefully you're thinking that the base of those is 2. So we can write this as 2 to the third. And we can write this as 1 over 2 to the fourth, which is then raised to the x power. Hopefully everybody gets what's going on there. Now remember, when I raise a power to a power, that means that I can just multiply those two. So this becomes 2 to the 4x. Now, I've got an exponent on the bottom of a fraction, so I can move that, not a great term, but I hope you understand what I mean, to the numerator of the fraction by turning this into a negative exponent. Remember, that negative exponent street runs both ways. So this now becomes 2 to the negative 4x. Now, I want you to take a quick look at that. If that makes sense to you, then you've got the basic idea of what's going on here. As you can see, we've now got bases on either side of the equation that are exactly the same. So now we can kind of forget about the bases, and we're just going to set the exponents equal to each other. So we get 3 equals negative 4x. Divide both sides by 4, and we end up with x equals negative 3 over 4. If you feel okay about that, then you've got the basic idea about what's going on here. Step 1, get the bases so they're the same, generally by playing with powers. Then set the exponents equal to each other and solve for x. Let's take a look at one more. 1 over 27 to the x, and again, these come directly from your book, equals the fourth root of 3 all to the x minus 2 power. Now, hopefully when you're looking at this, you see this 27 and you see this 3 and you go, okay, I got to get these back to 3. So I'm going to go through a bunch of steps here without writing it all out because my board space is limited. Hopefully now this makes sense that you can think of this as 1 over 3 to the 3x, because 27 is 3 to the third. 3 times x gives us 3 to the x. So I'm going to, 3 to the 3x. Hopefully you feel okay with that. This one gets a little more complicated, but just follow me on it and rewind it if it doesn't make sense. So the fourth root of 3, remember, we can always write roots as fractional exponents. So we can think of this as 3 to the 1/4 power. And we're then raising that to the x minus 2 power. So all we have to do to take care of all that is just multiply 1/4 times this binomial. So that's going to give us, 3 to the 1/4 x minus 1/2. Rewind it if what I did there was a little tricky. Now we're close. We're not ready to go until we've got a 3 on both sides. So all we need to do is deal with this one. Move this one to the numerator. This becomes 3 to the negative 3x equals 3 to the 1/4 x minus 1/2. Now we've got the bases the same. They are related. So we can then set the exponents equal to each other. Negative 3x equals 1/4 x minus 1/2. We're going to multiply the whole thing by 4. That's going to give us negative 12x equals x minus 2. Subtract x from both sides. Negative 13x equals negative 2. We're going to divide both sides by negative 13, and a negative divided by a negative equals a positive. So our final answer here is going to be x equals 2/13. Now, I would normally stop this video because it's actually getting a little long. I try to stay at that 10-minute limit, but I want to show you one more example in your notes that might throw you for a loop, because it's actually going to be a quadratic equation that you have to solve. And you may have wondered all this time why you had to do that, and now you're going to learn why. So here's one with some e. So let's try this on for size. E to the x squared power over e to the 10th equals e, I want to make sure I get this right, to the x, and then that to the 3rd power. Now, don't be afraid of e. Remember, e is just a constant. It just represents a number. But we're going to just try to get our bases the same, so we don't need to worry about the number. We're just going to work with e. This sign should seem pretty simple to you. I have x squared on top and a 10 on the bottom. This becomes a negative 10. So when I move it to the top and multiply, remember, I'm just adding and subtracting exponents. So this becomes e to the x squared minus 10 equals, multiply these two, e to the 3x. Hey, good news. Our bases are now related, so we can now just set these two things equal to each other. So we get x squared minus 10 equals 3x. We're going to subtract 3x from both sides, because since we have an x squared here, we got to do that old quadratic equation thing. So let's see if you can remember how this works. So we end up with x squared minus 3x minus 10 equals 0. And if you remember, when we have a quadratic equation, the way we solve for x is by setting it equal to 0 and then factoring it out so that we don't have any exponents. And then we just solve for our possible values. Hopefully you remember how to do this. We're looking for two numbers which multiply to negative 10, but which add together to give us negative 3. In this case, that's x minus 5 and x plus 2 equals 0. And then we just set each one of these equal to 0. So hopefully this makes sense to everybody. X plus 2 equals 0. We subtract 2. So the first possible value is negative 2. X minus 5 equals 0. We add 5, and that gives us 5. So that's our solution set. Guys, once you get the hang of this, it's really going to be pretty simple. I don't want to waste too much more of your time. There is going to be a supplemental video for you to take a look at as well. Your e-text is really short today. So take a second, look at it. I think everybody should do pretty well with this once you get the idea. It's just a review. Get the bases so that they're the same, and then set the exponents equal to one another. Tomorrow, we'll take a look at applications with this. Don't forget, if this or the last couple of days don't make sense, I'll see you at 10 o'clock if you're logged on by then. If not, you can always watch that conference on record. Thanks, guys, and I'll see you tomorrow. And a Britney song was on, so I put my hands